Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh is the...
Dr. Doreen is an expert in autism.
Doreen Granpeesheh.
Dr. Granpeesheh.
Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh.
Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh is a visionary in the field of autism. Now you can ask her questions on Ask Dr. Doreen.
We've got a question that is coming to us from, as Facebook tells us, one of our top fans. They categorize people now and they go, oh, this person is a top fan. So a five-year-old is constantly removing pants and pull-ups and keeping hands down there constantly. It's becoming a big problem, especially during ABA sessions and Zoom school. I don't know how to change this behavior. I tried pinning shirt and shorts and tying a string very tight, which sounds concerning. So what advice do you have for them?
You know, like, I'm always amazed, Shannon, that so many of our parents are struggling with things even though they have an ABA program. So this is kind of why your ABA program is there. You know, we are there to help with these specific issues. I can imagine that it's a difficult thing with distance learning. This is, you know, short of being able to tie the pants on in a way that the child cannot open them, which would be pretty difficult. The only other thing that you can do is block the behavior, prevent the behavior from occurring. And really, if you prevent the behavior from occurring, you would need to someone would physically need to be there, obviously, to prevent the child from doing that, and would need to place the child on a reinforcement schedule of not doing that. So it's sometimes we reinforce the absence of a behavior and we increase that period of time as well. So it is one of those things that can be done, but you would really need a behavior analyst to sit with you. And first they would get the, what we call baseline frequency. So they would measure a few things, like they would track, and you can help with these. When does it happen? Does it happen when the child is engaged in an activity? Does it happen when the child is alone? What are the circumstances where it happens? Wherever possible, we want to prevent those circumstances, but obviously it's not always possible. So now we get the frequency in under those conditions. So let's say it happens when the child is alone, and then we want to see, and no demands are placed, right? So during that period of time, we want to see what is the, how often does it happen? And we get a baseline of that. So for many different days, we measure how often it's happening. Now let's say, and then we average that up and we say, oh, you know what, every time he's alone, within 10 minutes it begins. And even if you come in and interrupt it, it'll keep recurring and that sort of stuff. So once you have that information, now the goal is to expand that 10-minute period to 11 minutes of non-occurrence. So, you know, now we're going to leave him alone for 11 minutes and then come in and heavily reward. Good job keeping your hands on the table. Great job. And here's a big reinforcer for you. And so you basically shape the behavior of not opening his pants and not playing down there. And so, and at the same time, it would be very helpful if you are, it will increase the period of non-occurrence if you give the child something that occupies his hands otherwise. So for instance, an activity that requires use of your hands so that he doesn't think about doing that, right? So it's something completely different. And at the same time, obviously, if the task is more difficult, in other words, if it's difficult for him to undo his pants, then that helps as well. Now, those are sort of behavioral techniques that you can use. It does take quite a bit of effort because it does take someone to be there, and it is a shaping procedure. And shaping procedures usually take a lot of time because you have to do them very gradually. At the same time, You probably, I mean, I don't know the level of functioning of the child, and that's always the issue with our show. But if your child is at the point of functioning where it matters to him how other people perceive him, then it is probably a good time to begin giving him some education, some instruction about this being a private activity and not an activity that you can do when others are either on the computer or around you. It is something that should only be done at, let's say, night when you're in your bed alone. So you start to put rules around this behavior so that the child isn't prevented altogether, which would be kind of not a normal thing, right? But it is limiting that behavior to private moments, perhaps when he's in bed in his at night alone, as opposed to when he's, let's say, in distance learning or if someone else is around. And you start to regulate that so that he, all these types of, you know, behaviors, if as long as we can put them inside an appropriate time frame and move them to a specific time of the day, it's easier to manage, because from the child's perspective, it's like, okay, it's easier to wait for something that can occur than eliminate that behavior altogether. The last thing I want to say about that is that, anytime that you reduce something that is intrinsically rewarding, and this is intrinsically rewarding. It is one of the reinforcers. Masturbation in general is one of the reinforcers that is considered a primary. It's as rewarding as food, for instance. So anytime you reduce a reinforcer in someone's life, you need to replace it with a reinforcer somewhere else. So the best thing you could do is to engage the child and keep the child very, very busy and give them a ton of reinforcers when they're not engaged, like instead of allowing them to engage in this activity. It could very well just be a habit that can be broken just by keeping the child super busy and super reinforced.
Yeah, I love that advice. And I would hope that, because you say that he's doing it during ABA sessions, I would really hope that your therapist would be all over that.
Right.
I do want to say, from the perspective of, hearing so many parents talk about this, I remember when my mom was still alive, and my mom was a sewer, and she got very interested in a thread where parents were talking about how do you keep your kids out of their pants, either from, you know, touching themselves, or for instance, there was one girl that was taking her poo at night and smearing it on the walls. And parents were giving all these different suggestions. But one of the ones that my mom got really excited about this, because she was a sewer and she could conceptualize this. But, overalls are something that work really well. Not your standard overalls that are like loose on the top and have those clippy things, but they make, you know, onesie overalls that have a button way up here so that they cannot get their hand in the side of the overalls. And that cuts down on a lot of different things, although they can still touch themselves through the fabric. But the other thing that parents really, that weren't sewers were doing, was buying summer weight footsie pajamas. And they would cut the arms off of it, and, you know, cut the feet off of them, and they would put them on their child backwards, mm-hmm. so that the zip or the snap is in the back. And then you put, you know, they got to be really lightweight summer, but then you put their shorts on top of that, and there's no getting in there.
That's
kind of genius, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Honestly, Shannon, like this is just like blocking, right? It's yeah. The same as having a person there. With much less effort. So yeah, if you can, a lot of times these types of behaviors are habits. And once you prevent the child for a period of time, they engage differently.
But I love, one of the many things I love about you, Dr. Granpeesheh, is that you make the point that this is something that's pleasurable. And in the right circumstances, you know, there's nothing wrong about it. It just has to be in the right place. And that when we take something away in one circumstance, we need to give them something that's as rewarding or more rewarding, because that's the humane thing to do. It's also the thing that works, right?
Well, absolutely. And aside from the fact that it is the right thing, it's the humane thing, what I often see, Shannon, is that parents, will do an intervention, and, you know, interventions are not always fun. They're demand, you're placing demand, and you're preventing things that the child has naturally gotten into that are possibly rewarding. And then over time, you end up just making an environment for the child that's completely aversive. And then you wonder why the child is getting aggressive or upset or, you know, resisting all instruction. It's because the amount of reinforcer in their environment has reduced. And if you think about it, that is true of everyone, not just our kids, all of us, right? I mean, it's funny, we started this show by talking about what have we started doing during COVID, right? Yeah. And if you think about it, COVID has brought with it some removal of reinforcers, just natural removal, right? Like, we cannot really see our friends as much, which was reinforcing. We can't go out to restaurants. We can't go to movie theaters. We can't go to parks. There's a lot of stuff we cannot do anymore that were reinforcers. So we all are at home, and what are we doing? We're trying to think of ways to reinforce ourselves with those crafts and things we were talking about. So it's natural, and it's human nature. As parents, we need to just make sure there's a balance of reward for our kids, especially if we get into really good, high quality ABA programs, which are demanding, because it's like intensive tutoring. So we just need to make sure there's an increase in reward as well.
Yeah. And, we always are talking on the show here about quality ABA, because for years I was just talking about ABA, and then I realized, oh, everybody didn't have the same ABA. It wasn't all equal and even, it wasn't all quality ABA. But quality ABA, I love what you always say, it has to be fair, it has to be just, and there has to be stuff in it for the kiddos. Otherwise, it won't work, and it's not the thing that's right. And I really love that about what you do.
Hey, thanks for watching Autism Live. To subscribe, click here. And if you'd like to check out some more of our videos, click here.